Hello everyone, and today I just want to continue the little nostalgia trip we've been going on with the last sort of week or so. I've been going back to a lot of the decks that I sort of started the game with and sort of started the whole YouTube journey, if you will, and replaying them just to have a bit of fun with them. Swordsoul, of course, being the first video we ever posted. So I did want to sort of come back to it, and honestly, we had quite a number of entertaining games. So basically, I've just been playing around. If I can happen to pick up a couple of entertaining games that I thought were really cool or fun, I just sort of take them out, and then we talk about them, make a wee video about it. Nothing sort of serious, it's not a big deck review or a profile or anything like that. Everyone knows how to play Sword Souls at this point, knows how to build Sword Souls, and if you don't, you can watch the gameplay to sort of piece it together, or you can watch some of our previous videos for a full deck breakdown. Here, we're just going to be going over some of the very basics of it and showing off a couple of very interesting replays. So if you like that style of content, or if you like what you're seeing and you want to see anything more, feel free to subscribe and like the video and leave me down below what sort of decks that you began your journey with. Like, what got you into, if you are playing competitively, what got you into playing competitively? If you're maybe not playing competitively and it's more sort of on a casual level, then what sort of things would you play in on a sort of casual level? Are you a fan of, you know, classics like Dark Magician, Blue Eyes? Are you on the fringe with, you know, some sort of like anti-meta options? You just let me know. Whenever I think of ranked, I think of Swordsoul. Swordsoul is actually the deck that, again, I play in the TCG and I would bring to locals. So it's a deck that I have a lot of familiarity with and one that I am a personal fan of. I know everyone's a wee bit sick of seeing it on the ladder, but again, it's one of my favorite decks, so I'm gonna play it. What do you want to do? But yes, that's pretty much it. If you want to sort of see how it works, just pay attention to the games. We show off some of the more fringe options, and it's not going to just be cookie-cutter gameplay. So without further ado, let's get into game number one. Already getting into game one here. Going first, really solid hand, so you'll love to see it overall. We're going to go Emergence off the bat just to fish out a potential Ash Blossom, which we do successfully. Great. That means now the Maxi in our hand is a lot more deadly, which is fantastic. We still have the Muyi in hand. We normal summon, reveal the second Emergence. We're going to get Impermed here, actually, which is quite a big deal. Given the hand we have, we don't have Circle or anything like that to protect ourselves, so that sort of kills our turn. We do, of course, have the Maxi for, you know, sort of limiting our opponent's plays, and we have the Ecclesia for some follow-up. So luckily, we're going against Marincess here. We're going to try and hit him with the Maxi, but they have the Call by the Grave. That, again, is rough. Our opponent here has basically countered everything that we were trying to do. So Maxi is no longer an option. We basically just have to sit back and hope we survive. Again, we all sort of know what the combos for Marincess are, so I'm going to speed through them a little bit. They're going to add Spring Girl back to hand here, Special Summon out to the field, then they're going to link off into Anemone. Anemone then revives from the graveyard. Then they're going to basically just use their monsters to link climb. I know there's a lot going on in screen, but it's essentially just extension. Coral Triangle here is a key part of the strategy because it's going to search their trap card. Everything else is just extension. So they're going to link into what? Sea Angel. Sea Angel searches for a spell. Yep, they're going to grab the Battle Ocean. Then they link up into the Aqua Argonaut. Now, the Argonaut basically is, it's a Link 4 monster, first of all, so it's going to facilitate their main plays, and it also has the ability to negate a spell or a trap card, which means that our Emergence is going to be very easily negated. So we're in trouble. So why are we in trouble? Anyone who hasn't played against or played with Marincess, this is why we're in trouble. Because he controls a Link 3 or higher, or Link 2 or higher Marincess monster, he can essentially activate this card from his hand that negates the activation of one of our face-up monsters, which is fine, except for the rest of the turn after its activation. If you control a Link 3 or higher Marincess monster, they're all protected, essentially. I mean, I got the links wrong way around there, but essentially what it does is negates one of our monsters and protects all of his huge monsters for the rest of the turn. We're going to go Muyi here, reveal Emergence, out comes the Marincess wave, but that's fine because we have the Taya. Taya is going to be a bit of a lifesaver here because Muyi is going to get negated, which is fine, but we're able to bring a Taya, banish the Emergence to summon a token. Token and the Muyi then are going to be used to summon out the Grand Master. Grandmaster then searches our deck for another Swordsoul card. Muyi allows us to draw. So we were still able to make plays happen there off the back of it, just because we had the Ecclesia and the tie in hand, which is a very powerful combo. We banished the Blackout from our deck, specifically so that we could get another token. Now we're going to banish the... this was bait. We didn't actually want to banish the Drone Lockbird, because we want to use our Emergence. we just wanted him to basically get rid of his material off of his Argonaut, so now his attack points are lower than 2800, and it makes him vulnerable to attack. Now we're going to go into the Draco Berserker. Berserker is going to enable a lot of damage here. We're going to take out the Argonaut, which is going to boost our attack points up by its original attack, boosting us up to 53. Then we take out his Enemy, and it frees him up for a direct attack here from the Grandmaster. So while it isn't game, it is the removal of virtually all of his resources, as well as a massive amount of damage. We have Negate, we have Banishments, we have all sorts of things going on here. Coral Triangle going to banish itself from the graveyard to summon the Anemone from the grave, as well as the Sea Angel. It basically summons Link monsters up until a Link 3 total. Now, Crystal Heart is another big part of the strategy. This is before even the new support came out. Crystal Heart, whenever it's used for material for a Link monster, the Link monster used it as material, so long as your field spell is face up, is unaffected by other card effects. So this Bubble Reef is completely unaffected by anything. So the Battle Ocean's going to equip on all of the Link monsters from the graveyard, boosting its attack way, way up. It's got the Marincess Wave in hand here, so he's basically keen to get battling right over again, turning that one card they had remaining in their hand into basically their ideal situation. So we need to be very careful here. We draw into Ashuna, which isn't the greatest draw in the world, but it's also not terrible. They're going to activate their Bubble Reef here. I activated the Berserker. We know it's unaffected, but we just wanted to see if he's going to use that opportunity to go into the Marincess Wave, or if he's going to save it. So we're going to use Emergence. We're going to grab the Strategist from the deck to hand, discard Ashuna for the Strategist, summon it and a token, Link off into the Baron de Fleur. Now, the target for Baron de Fleur is not going to be his monster, obviously. We're going to be taking out the field spell. That's where he's going to go for Marincess Wave, and he's left it too late. Now we have the opportunity to negate the Marincess Wave. So once the wave and the field spell are both gone, his monster is no longer protected from it, basically by card effects. Its attack points all go way down, meaning our Berserker can swing over it. So rough situation there. That shows an awful lot about how to counter Sword Souls as well. Our opponent had a very strong opening in that they were able to stop the Moyi. A big problem that Sword Souls has is that if your normal summon gets disrupted, not every hand is able to play without it. Sometimes if you get some of your Tenyi monsters or Circle or whatever, you can sort of play through it, but not always. So being able to negate the initial summon there from like the Moyi or the Taya or whatever it is usually going to be a surefire way to shutting down at least a massive part of their strategy, if not their entire turn. Our opponent had loads of resources. Should have been an easy win for them. Luckily, we sort of had a way to get around it whenever we top deck into the Taya, so it is what it is. That's pretty good. Let's get into game number two. Alrighty, game two here, and this is a really good one, so it is. You can tell by our opening hand, we're not feeling all that great about our options here. Emergence is going to search our deck, but we are under max C. We do sort of decide we're going to grab Taya for follow-up, but we're not actually going to be using it. We're going to set our Imperm and hope Imperm and max C is enough to buy us a turn. Unfortunately, max C is useless because we're playing against Floanderese. Rough, if there's one deck that everyone hates more than Sword Souls, it's Floanderese, myself included. They're going to go Rabina here off the bat, adding the Eaglin back to hand. We're going to flip Infinite Impermanence now, simply to negate the Rabina from getting their additional summon, but they've got the Crosshead Designator, so this is another situation where we're in a very bad situation off the bat, and our attempts to minimize the impact of our situation have been completely stopped. So our opponent, unfortunately, is just going to get to go off. He's going to get all of his plays. Rabina's going to grab the Barrier Statue. This was pre-ban list. Eaglin then comes out. Eaglin searches the deck for the M-Pen here, and it will allow the additional summon of the M-Pen from the hand. M-Pen's going to search the deck for a spell or a trap card, basically. Rabina's going to add itself back to hand for recycling use later. Not sure if that was the greatest of plays, but it does protect his M-Pen at least. It's going to grab the field spell and normal summon out Stree. Stree is going to banish the spell from the graveyard to allow an additional summon again. So out comes the Barrier Statue, and there is his field spell. So he's able to reveal the Rabina to banish an Eaglin, the normal summon the Rabina. Why he would do that, I don't know, but he did. So here we are. So this is a pretty interesting board. So basically, because of this guy, we'll just taken it out. We wouldn't be able to special summon monsters except Wind, which is very powerful, obviously. So we need to take care of it first. Then we can use Taya to banish the Emergence to summon a token from the graveyard, summon a token to the field. Then we're going to take the opportunity to special summon out the Ecclesia. And this is this is sort of where you've got a massive advantage in this particular matchup, because Swordsoul's, there's one particular card we use that completely annihilates Flowing Ares. We're going to go Boxia here to try and bounce back the field spell as well as his M-Pen. Unfortunately, we're getting negated by Lost Wind, a very good card. Taya then milling the Ashuna to the graveyard, our Boxia getting negated, but we're just going to Synchro Summon into 12, Geomathmic Final Sigma. Final Sigma basically has two main effects. One, it is only affected by Mathmech cards, unaffected by all of our card effects, and if it inflicts battle damage by battling a monster, the battle damage is doubled. So our opponent here, I don't think they're going to quite understand what's going on. Eaglin, reveal the banished Rabina. They're going to summon out the Eaglin to the field here, as well as triggering Rabina from that, from the banished pile that attacked the hand. As you can see, our hand has been terrible. Our luck has not been great. He's had the out for most of what we've been doing, but we were able to summon out Sigma here, which is pretty interesting. He's going to go for Razia here. Ryza is going to try and bounce the Sigma and the Ashuna, as well as the Rabina. And of course the Shree is going to activate in the banish pile. I don't think he's quite understood that it doesn't matter what he does, there's no card effect that's going to impact our final Sigma. It's just here. He tries to half its attack points off of M-Pen, thinking he's going to be able to beat it by battle. That also didn't work. Well, now what? I'm going to speed it up here, because as you can see, our luck doesn't really change when it comes to drawing. We're going to take out his statue, the damage of course being boosted up to 4k. But there's nothing he can do, and it's Sigma is just that powerful. Pot of Duality, checking the top three cards of his deck, adding to his hand, he lost the Wind, which I'm only assuming he thinks is going to work. He's going to summon out the Shree again. Shree's going to get back his M-Pen basically by banishing it. Going to grab Toucan, going to grab the Eaglin, going to grab the Rabina, replenishing all of his cards back to his hand, banishing the M-Pen here so we can use Toucan to grab M-Pen back to hand. Going to summon out M-Pen. This is going to search his deck for another spell or a trap. It's going to add back Shree. It's going to grab the Lost Wind. It's going to summon Eaglin. Eaglin search for the Thunderbird. Normal summon Rabina. So he's just going crazy. He's summoning out every single one of his boss monsters here. He's got Ryza on the field. He's got M-Pen on the field. He's got the Apex Avian. And none of it does anything to us. None of it. It's all pointless. And you'll see he tries Lost Wind, trying to have our attack points down, but we're completely unaffected. Take out the Apex Avian. We don't care about any of his cards. The other two can sit there for all we care. It's going to draw one here off of the Extravagance, reveal double Nibiru, but again, we don't care about Nibiru either. He can't do anything. And I'm pretty sure our opponent sort of realizes it here. We take out the M-Pen. We take it out, and I think our opponent sort of realizes that he can't do anything and then he scoops. But yeah, I wanted to show that off just because the final Sigma doesn't find its way out onto the field very often. But if you're playing Sword Souls, play Final Sigma. Even just one copy, throw it in there, take out, I took out a Boxia. I only play a single Boxia now. But Final Sigma is definitely, it's going to win you games. It's going to win you games that you otherwise wouldn't have won, and decks like this simply have no out to it. So yep, really, really straightforward. Very slow game, to be fair, but you're playing against Flowing Ares, you're always going to be playing slow. So that's a game number two. Let's get into game number three, which is significantly faster. Already getting into the third and final game. Pretty standard hand here. We've got the Ashuna, showing off some of the Tenyi plays, just in case some of the viewers haven't seen this half of the deck before. So we summon out the Monk, going for Vishuda, banish the Ashuna here from the graveyard to summon the Adhara out to the field. Then we synchro summon into the Shizao. Now we haven't used our normal summon yet, which means we're still more than capable of doing so. Gonna grab our Strategist to reveal off of Mo Yi. Then we're gonna synchro summon using these two into the Draco Berserker. You've got a few options there, but we're currently locked into just using our Fiends. Worms. We're going to grab Ashuna back to hand here off of Adhara's effect, which we can now ditch to the graveyard to summon the Strategist and the token. Then we link 10 into the Supreme Sovereign. Now again, we are locked into Worms, so no put on the Fleur, but this guy is plenty strong as it is. This is your sort of ideal broken busted board. Our opponent's got the Chaos Space here. We're going to activate now to banish. So if you don't know what this guy does, whenever your opponent activates a spell or a trap, or if they special summon a monster, you get to banish that card as well as inflicting 1200 points of damage, and you can do both effects in one turn, so one spell or trap and one monster. We're banishing this now so that he doesn't get the additional draw off of it later, which isn't much value, but I figure since he's playing Chaos Beast, he's not going to be playing a bunch of continuous spells or traps. Going to summon out his Black Dragon to bring out the Striker Dragon. Black Dragon Collapsibrant as well as the Striker Dragon are going to activate, searching his deck for a bunch of cards, grabbing the Boot Sector Launch as well as the White Dragon Wyverburster. He's got the Chaos Phoenix of Nephthys in his hand as well, so he's sort of setting himself up for some plays. Summons out the White Dragon, then links off into Romulus. Romulus is going to search the deck for Ravine here. We don't like the sound of that, so we're going to use our Grandmaster to negate the Romulus. Ravine is a very, very powerful card, and I suppose that is one of the better targets for your Sinister Sovereign. We could have held on to that until he had used one of his field spells, but again, we didn't really care too much. Out comes the Absol Router. Tracer is going to try and destroy the Absol Router here to summon another Rocket from deck. We're going to Effect Veiler that. We don't need to use our Draco's Banish yet. We don't need to use our Sinister Sovereign's Banish yet. We're holding on to them. Out comes Mascarina. We decide that this is going to be a good opportunity now to use the Sinister Sovereign to stop him from summoning out whatever crazy boss monster he's going for. We don't want to be dealing with that. IP is gone. He's going to grab Rocket Caliber here from his deck to his hand. He's now going to summon out Leviathaneer. We're going to banish the Leviathaneer off of our Draco Berserker here. So yes, its effect is still going to resolve, but he doesn't have the monster anymore. So we're dramatically reducing his ability to follow up. Out comes the Boot Sector Launch he can use to summon out the Caliber. Caliber goes into Striker. He's realizing very quickly he doesn't have very many options left, and he scoops it up. So basically what we had done is we just continually ground through and burned through all of our opponent's extension, banishing cards, destroying cards, negating cards time and time again. That's the type of thing that the deck can do when everything goes well. The first two duels were examples of what you do when things go wrong. So that's pretty much it for game number three. Like I said, very, very quick one. We're not going to be doing a full deck profile because we've done that in the past and the deck hasn't really changed, but we will be doing a quick overview. Alrighty, well, I hope you enjoyed watching the three games there. We're not going to be doing a deck profile, like I said. We've done it quite a number of times before. I don't want to bore people who have already seen that before. But if you do want a deck profile, just pop into one of the previous videos on the deck and you'll get a full card-for-card breakdown. But yes, hope you enjoyed watching the gameplay. Let me know which one of the games was your favorite. I, in particular, really like the Floanderese game in the middle. Just the Final Sigma is just such a powerful card. I actually went that day and ordered Final Sigma for my TCG deck. I realized that I didn't have a copy of it in my real deck, so I went and ordered it immediately after that game. But yes, that's basically it. Swordsoul is a very common deck. I believe it's tier 1 at the minute. It's very, very powerful, very simple to pilot, very easy to use. It's not the cheapest of decks. The only main deck you're playing that's actually core is Mo Yi, but you do have quite a number of extra deck ones, so I'm not going to say it's budget friendly, but there is definitely more expensive decks out there. But yes, that's pretty much everything I have to say in the deck, and I hope you enjoyed. I'll see you on the next one.